When you own a sailboat and you meet another sailboat owner, you instantly become friends. I was filming the next episode of Sailing EV in Bimini, Bahamas at Radio Beach, and a man walked up to me asking about my camera equipment. We realized we're both sailors, and he offered me to take us on a tour of his $3 million custom catamaran. So join me as we see the reality of owning such a vessel. We don't go on the inside because I believe in privacy. The man has a family. But we do a deck tour, we look in the engine room, and we talk about the real reality of owning such a vessel. Let's get into the video. Unbelievable. I'm here with Francois. He's a South African gentleman. Say hello to YouTube.
Hi, YouTube.
Look at his vessel. I mean, look at this beast. She is a beautiful catamaran. It's a Catitude? Or that's the name of the vessel?
The name is Catitude.
The name is Catitude, but what's the maker?
It's a South African catamaran, and it's branded as an X5. And the original guys who manufactured it is in Atlantis in Cape Town. Wow. So where all the... Yeah, that's where quite a few of these South African catamarans that you see around, like Leopards.
Right, are built there?
Are built there.
Really?
I believe there's...
So it's a famous boatyard.
I don't know if this is correct, but I've heard that South Africa is now almost the amount of boats they produce is at par with France.
Okay. Because ML's a big yacht builder in France.
That's right, but I'm specifically now mentioning catamaran builders. I think South Africa just overtook France.
Wow.
As catamaran
builders.
I don't know if that is the...
Unbelievable.
But this boat, she was built in like the semi-desert. Wow. Just north of Cape Town.
Okay, wow.
In a place called... the Karoo.
Cool.
And it's amazing how a boat like this that looks like a spaceship is built in the semi-desert place in the southern part of Africa.
I mean, look at the, just incredible. Look at these windows here. It looks like shark fins. Look at this. This, guys, I gotta get me one of these. I'll tell you, he's got the double. This is how it's done, folks. I mean, you look at my boat, and man. You know, maybe one day you can dream, right? But I mean, look at this.
Dreaming.
Oh, look at that. You can just tell she's
Come on, Bo. Her name is Bo, and she always barks. And this is Gideon.
Yeah,
Gideon is a good seagull.
Unbelievable, guys. There is quite a possibility that we're gonna go inside and have a quick look at some of what's going on inside, but that's a possibility, so stick around. So look at this place, it's unbelievable. So they got the kayaks, look at all the fishing rig, lots of solar. I mean, it's incredible. Anyway, Francois's gonna show us the helm station right now. Let's take a look. Look at this, unbelievable. Look at the size of the winch.
Yeah, so
this is where it all goes down, eh? Is this the only, can you also control the boat from the inside, or is it just here? One helm?
Yes, so normally how we sail is I make certain I sit here. And for example, when we cross over, I always just like half an hour in, just check right. If the engines is running properly. I'll show you the engines in a second.
Okay.
But
okay.
I realized like there was some cable ties not. And it was just hanging close to the fan belt, my wake speed alternator. And so I had a choice, and it looked okay, but do I now leave this? There's all these big tankers coming to and fro, as you know.
Oh yeah.
And you need to zigzag them and you're against the current because the current is
right.
The Gulf Stream. And now you have a choice, do I run down, get cable ties, and what I've learned is when yeah, things can go wrong, they will go wrong. So you don't want to be there in a way it goes into your engine room. So I try to stay put.
Right, right.
And not try to, like in the beginning when you're new, you know, run all over the place.
Right, right.
Because
right.
you weren't prepared in the first place.
So can you control all the sails from all these, so everything's ran to here?
Yeah, so everything is just rigged as all the helms go, comes to the cockpit. So you can navigate and sail the boat just from here without having to, go all
right.
the way up.
Right, especially when it's really crazy conditions That's out there, it's a safe thing, right? I mean, it's better for you to be.
Yeah, so one thing that we did change was this Admiral Canvas did this.
Mm-hmm.
And they
mm-hmm.
did an amazing job, just because you feel so, when we sailed in Canada, there was that issue of the American border being crossed and we couldn't leave
right.
in November.
Right.
And we were hitting the North Atlantic. With Luik, who helped us sail the boat from Canada, and this we had a situation where the boat, it was like 30 foot waves, and the boat went
wow
like 21 knots down these waves.
Jesus.
300 nautical miles in the ocean.
Whoa. Was it cold too? Was it in a...
And yeah, this is my, sorry. That, created, there was literally ice on the deck, on this
right.
deck. And you don't want to be on a catamaran with ice on the deck.
No.
But it was because some unforeseen circumstances
right.
that's not in our control, and the weather doesn't wait. But to get to the point of my story is this helm were very exposed, so you were sitting
right.
literally for 5 days and on a wet seat.
Yeah, yeah. So you didn't have this top at the time?
No, and sometimes the waves will not just come over the bow, it will just come over this whole area.
Jesus, really?
Yeah.
So did you add this, is that a piece of glass that was added after, or was this glass shield?
That was always there.
Always
but
there, okay.
But
these parts?
That glass is EZ2CY glass. It's like, the panel. Yeah, that one.
Yeah, this, it's
the way it's curved, it's almost, the way they say it's clearer than glass. Now, let's see how long it holds up, but at least we are now... We're not gonna get rained on, or
right? It's there's nothing worse than being cold and trying to sail, And I can tell you that from experience, definitely. I mean, it's I was in New Jersey in like November as well, and it was brutal, man.
That's not fun.
It's not. I had all the good gear, like the gloves and it was all right.
In Canada, we came into a bay, and like you said, if you're warm, I had woolen, woolen underwear, and I was wearing a jean and a jean jacket. So any sailor knows that is the wrong.
Big time.
Wrong. Okay.
Yeah, you need some Helly Hansen gear.
Yeah, and now I've got it. I've got all of that and this. But sometimes you just want to wear a jean, and you just want to,
You're the captain.
At sometimes you can't have your jacket and it just gets too much. But it wasn't. We were just taking the boat around the corner,
right?
And there was these crab pods all over the place in Canada, as you know.
Yeah.
And I was standing in front with this spotlight, like not this spotlight, but like a Stanley spotlight.
Right, right.
With a jean and a jean jacket. That was like all jean and slippers. you know, the I bought the slippers in Canada, but it's these woolen slippers.
Yeah.
You know, so nice and warm. And I was leaning over, you can show them, but there's this, I think it's like seagull wings or whatever, where I lean is standing right now.
Mm-hmm.
And I was way too close to the pool side. And, and as I was leaning over, the boat, not like a monohull that leans, it does this catamaran wobble. I don't know,
yeah.
It's like a sidestep. And as I was leaning forward, I stepped over that sea, and we were, I don't know, traveling at, I don't know how many knots, 3 knots or
right.
4, you know, it's, you just get into the bay or whatever.
Right.
And preparing the dock lines and just checking that everything is okay. And as I stepped overboard, tried to grab the rail on the port side just to try to fling myself around, because mm-hmm. I didn't want to go under the catamaran because the engines were going.
Right.
And then as I were hitting the ground, I lost my slipper.
Oof.
And I had some cigarettes in my hand. I thought, oh yeah, here goes a whole packet of cigarettes. And the most amazing thing was that Stanley light was still shining underwater.
Oh, wow.
And the first thing that I noticed when I looked up was the underneath, like the hull of this, the poor side of the catamaran,
right.
Like a coffin. Not to be melodramatic, but
that's crazy. Wow. So what happened? So the boat kept moving, and you were like,
okay. And then I just grabbed that rail at the back.
Oh, okay.
I dragged myself up.
So down there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I dragged myself.
Amazing.
Up. Larry at the helm, they were screaming man overboard when I was here at the, you know,
wow.
spring line cleat.
It's an amazing story. Now, I'm sure everyone's wondering, they want me to ask this question. Do you, when you chose to buy a catamaran, now that you've sailed some distance with it, are you happy with your decision versus buying a monohull?
That's the question that I still struggle with in my mind.
Really?
Okay. Because I'm originally a windsurfer and a kite surfer in England. And then 10 years ago, 8 years ago, I started sailing in Canada. That's where I and that was on a westerly catch. And that, there's a love for monohulls that, and the beauty of a monohull. I mean, you can't beat it. This looks like a spaceship to me.
It does look like a spaceship. It's amazing. Can you show us some of the parts of the deck, and we can maybe look at? I see that you've got two sails up there. So what would that be called on a catamaran? Would that be called a jib and a?
Yeah, well, it is a self-tacking jib and what they call a screecher.
So a screecher. Yeah, okay.
And some people put like a bowsprit on it, and then they've got like, you know, what code zeros in there. But I don't have anything like that. What I do have is a parasailer. It's like a kite, so that's
no way.
Yeah,
and it'll move the boat.
Yeah. That thing.
You gotta be kidding me!
So
so can you control it too? You like, if you want to go this
like
way, you're
kite.
Like,
that is
cool.
I would like hard over, you know. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
And that's the thing. If you do downwind, that you
right.
You know how it is with a screecher. You need to, you know, take all your these lines and pull it over when you want to do a jibe or tack or
right.
whatever. The reality of this thing is it's like moving a boat. It's not sailing. It's not that
really.
Yeah, it's not like,
so what
when you decide to take this out, for us at least, with being a big family, it's, you can see, you settle in, you stay for 2 weeks or 3 weeks, and then you have to go again. And
right.
And the majority of the time we will spend on anchor.
Right. Do you find it hard to sail this vessel? I mean, is it something that you need to be, if I was to go out and buy a vessel like this, how long do you think it would take me before I became proficient at sailing this vessel here? How long did it take you to learn?
So, I really started to understand the ocean being a Kaiser.
Ah, so you've had an event.
Yeah, yeah. You right. know the feeling of how you can get dragged with a kite to the rocks and you don't want to be at the rocks. That, yeah. That's instinct.
A friend of mine, actually, Dave Young, yeah, he went into a coma for 4 months, was a kite surfer in British Columbia.
Yeah, that's yeah.
And people, he had like metal parts in his back and stuff from it.
I saw some guys being dragged in pool in England over a rogue.
My God.
You know, from the beach, a gus takes them like that, and then there's apartment blocks at the end. Mm-hmm. So that's a pretty. Wow. So that concept of, and I did have a little boat where I grew up, like a 5-horsepower little, you know, river boat.
Yeah.
Fishing boat. So I always loved boats, but we are in Toronto, that's where I learned how to sail.
That's where I'm from.
All the courses that you need to take.
Like Outer Harbor Marina. Were you at Outer Harbor? Or?
Yeah, wait, I know. So I only lived there for 3 years, but we lived, I took my lessons were at Toronto Sailing School.
Yeah, at the National Yacht Club. Yeah, I know where you're at. Toronto Sailing School, it's down in the far side. It's on the west
beach.
End. Yeah, I know where it is.
No, it was on the east.
The east side? I'm confused.
No,
Toronto's a big place.
We lived where it was called the beaches, and I think it's the, I can't even remember the sailing club there, but that's where I...
That's where you learned?
Learned, yeah. You know, how to, set the sail and set the course and use
right.
the radio, you know, that's something you need.
Yeah, where you got to understand the wind and how it's moving the vessel, you know, in certain conditions, when to tack. I mean, I started on sailing dinghies too, with like laser ones, twos, albacores. I owned a Sunflower.
But this is to answer your question on a catamaran is when we sail, because you also need to, depending on what crew you are, mm-hmm. if it's me and my family, then you need to be careful.
Yeah.
Because things can go wrong.
Definitely.
So we have a cat and a dog, and we've got a little, Cara, when she got on the boat, she was like 1 year old. And you need to be very aware of the environment and the conditions and the climate.
It's a big responsibility.
Yeah, so when we sail, it is, we try to have a nice calm day, because I felt what 65 knots feels like on this catamaran. I promise you, the wind gets blown flat in the Atlantic. It's as if it gets sheared. And you don't want that. You that thing about, can you tip a catamaran? I'm sure you can tip a catamaran.
Sure you could.
You know, I felt, I don't think, whatever people say, but if a wave is big enough or you fall overboard if you're not hooked in that condition. I don't care what people teach you about how to do your S maneuver to come back and pick someone up.
Right.
You can try.
What do you think is the real reality of owning a big catamaran like this? I mean, it's got to be quite a job. Like, how do you cope with it? Do you think it in generally it's worth the hard work and effort?
Yeah, so as I say, ignorance is bliss.
Yes.
I actually never owned, a boat before this boat. And I did get advice before I bought it.
Right.
Because my initial decision Eileen and I took were to just look at like a monohull,
right.
45-foot monohull. Actually, we looked at a Bayfield 36 in Canada.
Bayfields are great. The 36 is great.
We looked at that.
They're a heavy boat.
But realizing now what I'm, they do a laminated. Yeah. I asked the broker. He said, "Yeah, sure, you can take your family over." That wouldn't that reality. If you really in your heart decide to live on a boat.
Yeah.
So what I mean by living on a boat is like Michael or ourselves that have spent years on a boat, and that there's no second home or another place. The Atlantic is your home.
Yeah.
If you, to do that, you really have to love Love this.
Yeah, and we do though. I think it's worth it. I mean, everyone out there is probably wondering, you know, I'm gonna buy a boat, I'm gonna go sail around the world. That's what everyone initially thinks, but they don't consider the realities of living on a boat. You have to be able to fix things instantly. You got to be able to know how to, about electrical, about engines.
Yeah, cleaning black water tanks.
Yeah,
plumbing. So like a pump is so special to me.
Yeah.
You know, just how a pump can suck something and blow something out or clean it.
It's critical.
It's so critical. Water flowing, you need to know how water flow through a boat.
Right.
Trying to understand how solar works and the balance of using electricity, because electricity is not infinite.
Right, exactly. And managing that.
And managing that.
And then managing water, food, rationing. I mean, everything becomes a critical system when you're crammed into a boat, especially with a family.
Yeah, you know, water, all the frills of life goes away. So when we walk in a shopping center now, you go 99%, I can't have this on my boat. It's just gonna break or rot away.
Yeah, you're like, oh, this must be nice to be able to have access to put this in your trunk and drive it home. You can't own anything big.
You can't.
These are the things that you need to consider before even a beautiful yacht like this. Yeah. Things are gonna go wrong. You're the only one out here. There's no, you can't just hire a mechanic, you know, when you're in the middle of the ocean. That's the reality of sailing. But
there's also another part is, if you do not have the skills, watch YouTube channels and educate yourself.
Exactly.
But then there's also certain things that you really need help with, even in the beginning. And then you learn from the experts, and then next time you do it yourself.
Right, and every single day out here is a learning experience. So Francois is gonna show us the engines, which is a really critical. You buy an engine, you get a boat with it. That's a saying that kind of stuck with me.
Yeah.
Engines are so critical. So let's go take a look.
This is mine.
So there's two engines, correct, in each hull?
Yeah.
Okay, and are they Yanmar or?
Yeah.
You got a 4GE.
So it's two Yanmar engines, and the fuel tanks are below the bay.
So it's like a full. Look at that! Hey, wow!
I'll put on the light.
Incredible! There's a light. Yeah. Okay. Look at that, unbelievable. So this is the great thing about a catamaran, guys. You've got two engines. One fails, you have a backup. That's what's critical. On a monohull, you only have one engine. And if it fails, then you have sails to it. Essentially here, he has quadruple backup. He's got all his sails, he's got two engines. So this is how you can maintain your movement through the water. So let's take a look here. Incredible.
So it's Yanmar engines, and it's 80 horsepower, or is it 85? 80 horsepower. I'll get inside quickly and I'll show you a few things we've checked. Standard, it comes with this alternator. Mm-hmm. And the reality of sailing is, You use your engines, you know, when
Big
you want to move your boat, you use your engines.
Absolutely.
The issue with these smaller alternators, they don't actually give you sufficient power to charge your batteries quickly, because, you know, when you wake up in the morning and you go sailing, when you're on anchor, your battery, the level of your battery, say it's 65% or whatever.
Right.
And then when you start your motor, if you can use that little bit of power to get you up and charge your batteries quickly, so you put this wake speed in, wake speed 500 with this wake speed.
So let me guess, that's a computer controlled Balmar, is that correct?
It's
a Balmar.
They call it a regulator, advanced alternator regulator.
Right.
And that is...
So in a pinch, if you need power, you know, you can crank up your engines, you can charge the main batteries, you know, you just need to top it up and move it over 12.5 or something, you know, and get it back to 13, you know.
That's right. And this is called an AP, I think it's an APS alternator. It's a, what then?
Internally regulated.
It's American built.
Externally regulated.
American built alternator. And it gives me, I mean, I think like each one will give me over 1,000 watts, you know.
Unbelievable. Yeah, you get like probably 20 amps or you get more, like probably 100 amps even, like draw
power.
Yeah,
exactly.
Wow. So you can you can level those batteries quick, and it's the computer doing it. So it's like,
that's right.
You know, you can see the voltage going up and down.
So I had to, because it's so strong, and I don't have lithium batteries. I have just normal AGM batteries, 12 volts. I had to limit it. We had to limit it on 300 amps.
Right.
Just so that you don't over, you know, charge the batteries too quickly and. You know, you need to look after those batteries.
Yes. But, and you don't want to drain them too much, right? AGMs, with lithium, you can drain the shit out of them, right? But with AGM, you got to keep them topped up or they can damage them.
That's right. And then also, this is not critical. Well, I think it's critical. But what this does is, because the fuel tank, imagine the fuel tank is now under the bed, that fuel tank, the outlet normally goes through this water separator.
Right.
And when this line gets clogged, obviously your engine shuts down.
Yeah.
And when you have dirty fuel tanks, which I have had before, I've looked after my fuel tanks.
Was it algae in there?
There was actually.
Yeah, and like that, fuel growth,
and I've got some stuff you have to put that in, but you learn these things over time very quickly.
Yeah.
So that the port side engine actually cut out just on the northern side when we came from the very islands.
Did it? And was it because of fuel?
And it was because of the fuel line that's clogged.
Okay.
When that happens and you get blown and you only have one engine and you know it's 25 knots, then you, what this thing does, which is nice, is it allows you to run any engine from any tank because there's crossover lines here, cross supply lines.
So essentially you have a backup fuel system for
each
engine.
This it's called a Keenan filter. It's called Keenan filters.
Mm-hmm.
And the guy who designed it, the concept come from helicopters.
Wow.
Because
it's critical. You're in the air, dude.
Yeah, man, you can't have life.
Amazing, eh? Isn't that fascinating? See, this is what I love about boating, guys. There's so much involved. You're out here learning every single day. You know what I mean? Like, and it's just amazing that Francois has let us all look at his beautiful yacht, his catamaran. So thank you, Francois.
All good, man.
Amazing, brother.
Yeah, thanks, Michael.
I hope everyone appreciates the realities of living on a sailboat. It's something you need to consider and something that I love it dearly, you know, and we're very, very lucky to be out here. But at the end of the day, the reality of sailing is a very important thing to learn about. Hope you guys appreciate Francois letting us tour his boat. And that's it. We'll see you in the next video.
Join me as we sail deep into the wilderness of the Bahamas. Make a comment down below about what you think. What is the reality of owning such a yacht? What yacht do you own? Tell me down below. Hit the like button, subscribe to the channel, follow along with this crazy adventure. Captain Michael, signing out. Thank you.